should have maybe mentioned it first. I'd also thank Mr. Faisal Kutty for coming, all from Chicago. He's half in Chicago, half in Toronto, which is great that he took the time to come up. We'll also shortly hear an introduction by Dr. Nasser Khan, which is our local MIA religious advisor, and he's in a very busy time this year as he's finishing up his residency. So thank you, Brother Nasser. And of course, we have our guest interviewer, Mr. Terry MacLeod, which is no stranger to the Muslim community in Winnipeg. So thanks again. And you'll soon find out Terry has a great passion for these types of dialogue. So once again, there's a lot of you that are coming from rural Manitoba, so thanks again for coming out. I see some Altonians where I came from, so thanks for coming out, making the drive. My heart is always to the rural parts of Manitoba, so thanks for coming out. And this shows there's an importance to this type of topic and discussion. Especially since the past decade, there's been a lot of warfare and political chaos taking place in the world, even in the Muslim world. And it has led to demonizing Muslims as inherently violent or savage people with backwards or barbaric religion. And I remember as we took office, the new EC, or Executive Council of the Manitoba Islamic Association, it was only a few weeks, and then we were struck by the calamity of the terrorist attack on the Muslim or the mosque in Quebec, and it was pretty fearful time for the Muslims, as even in Winnipeg they were scared. Like, can we pray? Can we practice our faith? Do we have to stand guard while we're praying? But such a compassionate Muslim community, and even a Manitoba community that came out and showed their support. And I still remember this day, my son won't remember that tragedy. He'll actually remember the thousands of people that came out and supported the Muslim community as brothers and sisters, as we all should. Just to give you a background, so the Manitoba Islamic Association is doing a lot of work to build bridges with the surrounding community, with our open houses, our foodorama. John Reyes loves the foodorama. I don't even know if he knows what's going on, he just comes to the food menu. Thanks for coming up. And even people are welcome to come to our Friday sermons. Dr. Idris Al-Barki, our past executive, our past president, is running even a course on being Muslim that's being well received by all. And this is not done just by a few people. This is done with over 100 volunteers, as you saw Shannon doing the talk at the start, with all the volunteers that are around here, with youth and seniors. So it's a big effort, and I'd like to thank them all. And just a reminder, so this is a good starting point, and hopefully we'll get a lot from tonight's event and discussion. But we should hopefully take something moving forward from this and having a good place to start and stand up for each other as not only Muslims, but as Canadians. So hopefully this will even get us to come out into a discomfort zone that we're maybe not used to. But not only to stand for against Islamophobia, but any other type of discrimination or bigotry or hateful comments or situations. So I'd like to conclude with a quote from our Prime Minister, Justin Trudeau. Diversity is in our strength, and religious tolerance is a value that we as Canadians hold dear. And I look forward to the knowledgeable people that are going to come up and speak about Islamophobia and understanding the anti-Muslim sentiment in the 21st century. Thanks for coming, and I'd like to call upon Shaq. Thanks.
I'll just quickly introduce our next speaker. Our next speaker is going to be giving an introduction to our topic. Our topic again is Islamophobia. Dr. Nasir Khan is a physician, an imam, and a member of the Manitoba Religious Affairs Committee. He has memorized the Holy Quran and has received traditional Islamic certification known as ijazah in theology, Quran, and hadith. He is the director of research strategy at Yakin Institute, a think tank that brings together intellectuals to address pressing issues facing Muslim communities.
In the name of God, the most compassionate, the most merciful, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's my pleasure to be with you all here today. I want to start by taking us back in time and talk about something that took place in Norway on July 22nd, 2011. A man by the name of Anders Behring Breivik. This was a man who had written a manifesto describing Europe as being under the threat of Islam. He took action, he took matters into his own hands, and detonated a van, a bomb in a van, killing 8 people. And then he traveled, disguising himself as a police officer, to a camp for teenagers, where there were about 600 youth there. And he began opening fire on these individuals. Some of the people tried to swim to get to shore to escape, but were gunned down. A total number of 77 people were killed on that day. In the aftermath, in Norway, people tried to understand what was this about, and they found that Anders Behring Breivik had written a manifesto. And in this manifesto, he mentioned that he was defending Europe from the threat of Islam. He characterized Islam and Muslims as a threat. And in that manifesto, he cited many different Islamophobic speakers and writers. He cited a known American Islamophobic writer no less than 68 times in that manifesto. Hatred and dehumanization often leads people to take things into action and commit horrific atrocities. But hearing about this in the news, many of us would have said, well, that's far away, that's Norway. We wouldn't have something like that happen here in Canada. We're a multicultural society. We're tolerant. We accept people of all different diverse backgrounds. We foster respect and compassion and build bridges between different communities. And then comes January 29th, 2017, earlier this year, when Alexander Bissonnette enters into a mosque in Quebec City, at the time of evening prayers, and he opens fire on the individuals performing worship there. And I wonder what it would be like to be in that mosque, and what would happen if something like that happened in our mosque here. You read about one of the individuals, Isuddin Sofian, who rushed forward towards Bissonnette, the gunman, and was shot several times, giving his own life to try to protect others, and was recognized as a hero. You read about Muhammad Abu Khadir, an individual who was providing first aid for one of the victims, and he saw a man approaching him with a gun. Thinking it to be a gunman, he took off and started running. And the police thought he was one of the suspects. And of course, as soon as they arrested him and he spent the night in jail, Fox News had tweeted, "Man of Algerian background responsible for this crime." And of course, that spread all around the world as people said, ah, more proof, Islam is violent. And it turned out that this man was actually one of the heroes trying to help others on the scene. You know, it's shocking to really wonder what level of hatred drives a human being to pick up arms and want to inflict suffering, pain, and even death on another human being. What has to happen in their mind? What transformation has to occur for such a person to take that type of action? How can hatred be such a disfiguring force that it causes a human being to do such things? I started reflecting on this And researching into this topic, we find that this has been a general trend throughout history. Professor Gregory Stanton of George Mason University, he talks about the 8 stages of genocide. What are the stages that lead a population to commit violence against a minority? Well, first, the population has to dehumanize them, to depict them as criminals, to strip them of their humanity, to engage in so much hateful rhetoric that people no longer view them as equal human beings worthy of respect and dignity in society. And I wonder about that process of dehumanization. Are we doing enough to counteract it? Hatred towards any community harms all of us. And we need to stand up for the rights of each and every community out there. We need to speak out, whether it's against anti-Semitism, homophobia, racism, misogyny, or Islamophobia. Demonization and dehumanization of any human being is wrong. Now, what I want to touch on in this brief introduction is what are the ways in which Islamophobia is often justified. How does this Islamophobic rhetoric find such widespread acceptance in the public sphere? Why is it that it's become so popular? And what are the common excuses that are used to justify Islamophobic rhetoric? And this is important for us to consider because as we're seeing increasing acts of hate crimes and increasing violence, we have to realize that speech leads to action. And the more that this type of rhetoric increases, the more these kind of hate crimes are going to become a regular, recurring event. Dr. Luke Timmerman observes that hate speech regularly, if not inevitably, precedes and accompanies ethnic conflicts, and particularly genocidal violence. Without such incitement to hatred and the exacerbation of xenophobic, anti-Semitic, or racist tendencies, no genocide would be possible, and persecutory campaigns would rarely meet with a sympathetic response from the general public. The first excuse that is used to justify Islamophobic rhetoric is that this somehow helps us to identify the source of violence that's happening in the Middle East. People say, well, you have to know your enemy, right? And Islam is the cause of violence. And therefore, we need to speak out against Islam because Islam is causing all these different acts of terrorism and so on and so forth. But the problem with this type of rhetoric is it doesn't actually help us understand what's happening in the Middle East, for example. It doesn't actually help us to understand the phenomenon of terrorism today. It doesn't provide us with any sophisticated understanding of this topic. Instead, what it does is it lumps everybody together, and it lumps together criminal organizations with the average Muslim neighbor living next door, taking their kids to public school, and finding that their children are being bullied because they call themselves Muslim. This Islamophobic rhetoric provides this undifferentiated look of Islam. They're all bad, they're all evil. It's not just the terrorists who are evil, or the violent criminals, but it's Islam in general. And it makes the mistake of assuming that violence is intrinsic to one particular belief system. But the reality is, when we study history, we see that any belief system can be weaponized or instrumentalized for violence. Political movements routinely use belief systems for their own political agenda. Whether it's a religious belief system, like the Lord's Resistance Army in Uganda, or the KKK, or whether it's a non-religious belief system, like the way communism was used to perpetuate so much violence in the Soviet Union, under the regime of Stalin, for example, or with Pol Pot and the Khmer Rouge, where one-third of the population of Cambodia was massacred. Any ideology can be twisted and manipulated by political groups in order to perpetrate violence. The New York Times wrote in 2014, to claim that savagery is rooted in a certain people or a certain religion is to forget that the great atrocities of our age have been perpetrated on different continents by people professing different ideologies and different religions. Before ISIS, there was the genocide in Rwanda, and
and the Lord's Resistance Army, and the killing fields of Cambodia, and before that in Europe, the Holocaust. So, what we find when we look at history is any movement can twist religion to service its political agenda. Any movement can twist whatever ideology they want to carry out acts of violence. And focusing on the religion is not going to bring any solution. Instead, the key element to focus on is the xenophobia and totalitarianism that characterizes all of these movements. The hatred for the outsider, the otherization. That is how all of these violent movements perpetuate conflict. When we look at the phenomenon of ISIS in the Middle East, for example, is it correct to characterize ISIS as a religious movement? When we actually look at the facts, we find this characterization is grossly inaccurate. The New York Times reported that many of the leading generals in ISIS, leading the army of ISIS, were actually former Baathist generals from the regime of Saddam Hussein, which was a staunchly secularist regime, which was opposed to religious expression. So you have to ask yourself the question, what's more likely? Is it more likely that these anti-religious generals experienced some spiritual awakening overnight and suddenly decided to join a religious movement? Or is it far more likely that these were power-hungry individuals, opportunists, looking to get back into power and use whatever ideology they could to meet their political agenda? So when we look at these political conflicts that are happening in the world, to reduce all this problem and to religion and just say, well, it's all happening because of religion, religion is bad, it is a profoundly uneducated look at these problems. You have to look at the political factors. You have to look at how these movements arise in situations of political turmoil, in conflict, in the aftermath of warfare, where there's instability in regions. Also, this type of rhetoric doesn't help us understand issues of terrorism in domestic situations either. The MI5 released an intelligence report that talked about the phenomenon of radicalization of youth and individuals joining terrorist movements. And they said that far from being religious zealots, a large number of those involved in terrorism do not practice their faith regularly. Many lack religious literacy and could actually be regarded as religious novices. Very few have been brought up in strongly religious households, and there is a higher than average proportion of converts. Some are involved in drug taking, drinking alcohol, and visiting prostitutes. MI5 says there is evidence that a well-established religious identity actually protects against violent radicalization. When we think about that, and you think about recent examples, I mean, it was widely reported that many individuals who traveled to join ISIS, the last Amazon purchase that they had was Islam for Dummies. And you read about the 9/11 hijackers, and many of them were in the strip club prior to performing their hijacking, the prancing pony. So you have to ask the question, are these people religiously devout individuals? Or are these people just criminals looking to use religion to meet their own ends? And one of the things that we find with this rhetoric is that so many of those who are engaged in Islamophobic rhetoric are actually saying that, no, not only are these people representing religion, but their interpretation of religion is right, and the rest of you, 1.6 billion Muslims, mainstream Muslims, you're not real Muslims. You're not following a true version of Islam. Which is really shocking. Like, many of these individuals are actually affirming the understanding of Islam that terrorists are promoting, and saying, no, that's the right understanding of Islam. Islam does preach violence. On Bill Maher's show on HBO, many of you might remember Sam Harris came on and he said that no one's denying that there are hundreds of millions of Muslims who are peaceful, who are nominal Muslims. In other words, they're just Muslim by name. They're fake Muslims. But real Muslims are the ones who are committing acts of violence. And this is astonishing, because really what it means is that Islamophobes are trying to be theologians and telling us what is true Islam and what isn't true Islam. But who has the greatest right to define what is true Islam? It's the mainstream adherents of the faith. They're the ones who have the greatest right to say, no, this does not represent us. The Quran says, whoever slays one human being, it's as if he has killed all of humanity. The Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said, reach the true reality of faith until they love for all humanity the same good that they love for themselves. These are the values of Islam which characterize Islam in the minds of 1.6 billion Muslims. But too often the media dictates to us that our Islam has to be the Islam of terrorists, and the way that terrorists manipulate the word Islam. The second common excuse that's used to justify Islamophobia is that Islamophobia is not racism, and so therefore it's okay. And many of you may have heard this excuse. And it's a very peculiar excuse because, first of all, the reason that racism is reprehensible is not because it's hatred for someone based on their genetics or their skin color. It's because it's hatred of a community of people. Just like homophobia is reprehensible for that matter, or anti-Semitism is reprehensible for that matter, or misogyny is reprehensible for that matter. So to say that Islamophobia is justifiable because it's not hatred based on skin color is a really weird objection. It doesn't make any sense. It doesn't matter whether you're hating somebody for their skin color or for having a different culture or a different language or a different belief or way of life that they were raised with. Hatred and dehumanization of any human being is wrong. Secondly, the other thing that's interesting is a lot of these people may not actually realize, where does the term race come from? Does anyone know where the term race actually comes from historically? If we go back 400, 500 years. The term race, if you refer to a textbook on race by a University of Manchester professor, Peter Wade, he mentions that this term race actually comes from the Italian razza, or the Spanish razza, which was used to refer to the breed of a horse. And it was used during the Spanish Inquisition to say that people who were Muslim or Jewish, who were forced to convert to Christianity, had infected blood. And they weren't true or pure Christians. They didn't have a true breed. And so the Moriscos, Muslims who were forced to convert to Christianity, and the conversos, the Jews who were forced to convert to Christianity, were barred from any valuable position in society. They were discriminated against, persecuted, because they were seen to have infected blood and be from an inferior race. So the first time race was actually used for discrimination was not even based on skin color, it was actually based on belief. And was actually for discrimination against Jews and Muslims in the Spanish Inquisition. The third and final excuse that's often given for Islamophobia is that Islamophobia, if we ban it, then we're banning free speech. And we need to have the ability to criticize and utilize our free speech to critique ideas. And therefore, this whole idea of Islamophobia is going to restrict and restrain our free speech. And I think that people who mention this objection really don't know much about the concept of free speech. If you go back to John Stuart Mill, who's one of the famous philosophers who elaborate on the concept of free speech, what is the value of free speech? He mentioned that the value of free speech is creating an open space where people can express different ideas to arrive at the truth. But these individuals who are promoting Islamophobia have no interest in the truth. They have no interest in learning about Islam and Muslims. They don't even want to talk to a Muslim. They have only interest in demonizing Muslims. And so there's a big difference between free speech versus hate speech. Hate speech that has no intellectual interest or intellectual objective is just meant for the sole purpose of humiliating, dehumanizing, demonizing, marginalizing a population. And we've seen the repercussions of that type of speech. Prior to the Holocaust, the Nazis put out so much propaganda, repeating stereotypes of Jews as dishonest and untrustworthy. If you look at the Rwanda genocide, political figures use this type of stereotyping of the Tutsis as being dangerous. And this is the type of speech that actually has damage and has a dangerous impact. I want to close with reminding us of the verse that was recited at the beginning of this session, which is the verse from the 49th chapter of the Quran, where God mentions that, O human beings, we've created you in nations and tribes, male and female, so that you may know one another, so that you may familiarize yourself with one another. And verily, the closest amongst you in the sight of God is the one who is
virtues.
The point of having differences, diverse backgrounds, is not to label and propagate hatred, but rather to come together, to build bridges of mutual understanding and respect and dialogue, and to create an awareness. And if we do that, we can overcome hatred and dehumanization. Thank you very much for your attention.
So that's one of the biggest things that people say, well, you know what, why do we have to use Islamophobia? Well, the reason we use Islamophobia, it's not a precise term. I agree. I will give people who make this argument, it's not the most precise term. But neither is homophobia. Okay, there's a lot of contention as to what this means. Neither is anti-Semitism. There's disputes and debate. But we don't spend time debating, should we be using homophobia? Should we be using anti-Semitism? But when it comes to Islam, let's discuss the term. Forget about what's happening on the ground. Let's focus all our energies on battling what this means. The way I look at it is, when you're on a cruise ship, okay? The ship is sinking, God forbid. And the captain says to you, you know what? Jump onto that canoe, because that's how you're gonna get saved. I don't think most of us would stand and, you know what? You don't really use a canoe. We need a lifeboat. I'm gonna stand here and drown, right? That's how all of this controversy around the M103, the resolution about this non-binding resolution that the Upper College MP was trying to pass in Parliament. What did people do? They were debating, well, why are you using Islamophobia? Why are you using Islamophobia? Why are we spending so much energy on this word? This word has been accepted by academics. People have accepted this. This is what is used in common discourse, Islamophobia.
Well, the term has been around for many years, not widely used, right? Most of the money being trusted in Britain created the term at the beginning, right?
Well, even before that, the first recorded use of the term Islamophobia is actually in the early 1900s. When the Algerians were treated negatively, their culture was put down, their religion was put down by the French. And so the first use is Islamophobia, which is the French version of it. And then in the 1970s or so, Edward Said, well known for the writing of the book Orientalism, and what Dr. Khan mentioned about the othering of, you know, them versus us. So Edward Said used this to talk about the othering of the Islamic world, to treat it as this barbaric, exotic other, where we, the enlightened West, against the other. And so he's actually the first one who actually recorded in English language to have used this term. And then officially the Runnymede Trust adopted it and said, look, this is a term. And you know, there's all this back and forth. So in order to think about why people will say, why is it a phobia?
Yeah, what's the phobic part of it?
So here's how I define it. I define it as dislike, hate, prejudice, or bigotry against Muslims, or those perceived to be based on a narrow-minded and stereotypical projection of an assumed but not existing monolithic Islam represented by the Sharia boogeyman.
That's what it should be called. That's a good long phrase that describes the whole thing.
And the reason I say it's a phobia, because it's based on irrational and exaggerated fear of monolithic Islam. Okay, and how is it? And the reason I'm reading this, I want to be exact. People will say, oh, what do you mean by this? So it's irrational. Why is it irrational? Because Islam and Muslim as a monolith only exist in their imagination. To say, you know what, all of Islam, all of Muslims is bad, right? That only exists, this one idea of Islam only exists in their mind, in the mind of the Islamophobe, because Islam is a diversity. There's a plurality. Even within 100 years of the Prophet's death, a multitude of Islamic schools of jurisprudence developed, and they each claim to be Islamic, and nobody said the other is not Islamic. So there's a diversity of opinion. So, but for the Islamophobe, Islam is all negative, this one group. So, and the reason I continue to say it's not rational to assume that any worldview has only one interpretation. That's why it's irrational. It's also irrational because it allows a few fanatics to define Islam for themselves and for the 1.6 billion other Muslims. So it's irrational. How do you let a group of fanatics or criminals define what this whole system means for everyone, right? So in the United States, for instance, the United States Constitution, I can look at the Constitution, and I teach, you know, comparative law in the United States. So I ask my students in the class, I say, how many of you think that you should be able to carry a firearm? And so, of course, it rumbles into the room. And then